and welcome to the episode 4 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today, we're going to talk about the events of the 4th of January, with prizes, flops, and overdubbing, which, as we will see, means recording extra music on an existing track. But let's get down to business. On this date in 1962, it was announced that the Beatles had won the first Mercy Beat popularity poll for bands. The poll was so popular that the owner of the Rushworth's Music Shop, a supplier of musical instruments championed by many local bands, including the Beatles in their early days, presented John Lennon and George Harrison with two Gibson acoustic guitars. Let's move forward to the 4th of January 1963 and to the second date of the Beatles' Scottish tour, taking place at the Dingwall Town Hall in Dingwall. The show was attended by a whopping 19 people. Just to give you an idea of the magnitude of the flop, a local band, the Mellotones, were playing on the same night at the Strathpeffer Pavilion, a nearby venue, and their concert was attended by over 1,200 fans. While this might very well be the case of local pride in local talent, it is important to remember that the road to glory wasn't all smooth for the Fab Four, and there were setbacks along the way to keep their ego in check. Billy Shanks of Dingwall Business Association, who reunited the crowd for a memorial event in 2011, told BBC that some who turned up thought the music was rubbish and left. Olive Lees, daughter of the Mellotones leader Jimmy Stewart, happened to attend the Beatles concert and remembered, "My father told me the minibus to the Strath was full, so I'd had to go to the town hall. I wasn't bothered because the Mellotones would come round to our house and play in the sitting room. I remember the Beatles were late in arriving, and when they came on stage one by one, they were wearing three-quarter length leather jackets, long scarves, one was trailing his on the ground behind him, and wrinkle pickers. Everyone was laughing at them, but they were brilliant and they chatted with the audience between songs." 4th of January 1964. Early in the day, the lads were busy at the EMI Manchester Square headquarters in London, recording a series of open-ended answers for use by US disc jockeys. The replies were recorded so that they could be cut and inserted in between DJ's questions, giving the impression of a real interview. A photographer from Life magazine took pictures of the band at the EMI's headquarters for a proposed cover story to appear in the issue coinciding with the band's first appearance at the Ed Sullivan Show. During the evening, the 10th night of the Beatles' Christmas special went on as usual with two houses at the Astoria Cinema in London. In 1965, in the afternoon, Paul McCartney attended a luncheon at Café Royal in Regent Street, London, in honour of music publisher Dick James. James announced that during 1964, John Lennon and Paul McCartney had earned more than £1 million, about £22,400,000 in 2020 money, from their songwriting royalties in 1964. To think that only 2 years earlier people would leave one of their shows thinking it was rubbish. During the evening, the Beatles featured in the two houses of another Beatles Christmas show production at the Hammersmith Odeon Cinema, London. On the 4th of January 1967, the Beatles returned to the EMI studios after 4 days of break to keep working on new material. Today, between 7 p.m. and 2:45 a.m, the focus was on Penny Lane, with John overdubbing a new piano part, George recording a guitar part, and Paul adding a new vocal onto the best take of the rhythm tracks, take 7. All of these contributions were soon discarded, though. Paul's vocals were soon replaced on the next day, while John's and George's parts were erased on the 6th of January. For those that don't know how a recording session goes, we will talk extensively about that further down the line. But it suffices to say that a song is first recorded putting together a basic or rhythm track, with the main instruments playing the music. Then, if needs be, the musicians record additional sounds, instruments or vocals on this basic track. These further recordings are called overdubs. When the recording phase is over, there is the mixing. Each instrument or voice is pushed up or down in volume and changed a bit in character, enhancing or lowering some frequencies in the sound, so that the right balance between the different instruments is struck and the song sounds at its best. Some special effects, like echo for example, can be added during the mixing. Sometimes there is a mixing phase at the end of each major addition to the song, so that everyone can judge the results. When the mixing phase is completed, one ends up with a final version of the song, also called the master tape or the master take. After a procedure called mastering, which basically makes sure that the track plays well on a variety of sources, from a hi-fi stereo to a cheap transistor radio, the song is ready to be released. If this all seems too complex, don't worry. We'll talk about what's needed in a recording-heavy episode, or as we go along. Moving forward to 1970, for the last entry in this episode, the day sees George Harrison, Ringo Starr, and Paul McCartney working on Let It Be, the only song in the Get Back project to have received overdubs. A guitar solo in the middle section was taped on the 30th of April 1969. The song was to receive further overdubs today. First, the original bass line performed by John Lennon was replaced by a new take with Paul on bass. Then, George, Paul and Linda McCartney recorded some vocal harmonies. An orchestral score arranged by George Martin and featuring two trumpets, two trombones and a tenor saxophone was added to the track. George recorded a more incisive guitar solo, and then the song was further strengthened with more piano by Paul, more drums by Ringo, maracas by Paul and cellos for the finale. The 2:30 p.m. session at the EMI studio was wrapped up at 4 a.m. when the song was mixed in stereo. Engineer Glyn Johns got the master tapes of this and the previous night's work on I Me Mine to compile a new master take of the Get Back LP. Fun fact, the single version of Let It Be didn't feature the new solo, leaving the original 30th of April 1969 overdub in. This curiosity concludes today's episode. Please remember to visit www.simonmas.com/support to find out ways in which you can support me and my music-related projects, including What A Fab Day. You might want to know that I am preparing a special edition of the podcast with some extra material added here and there. I still have to decide what exactly will happen, but the special will serve as a thank you gift for those that support me the most. On my website, you will also find a form to contact me. I am always open to ideas and constructive criticism, but please remember that this is my first podcast after all. As usual, check out the description to find an Amazon affiliate link to buy the books used as a source for the podcast, if you so fancy. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.